Karen, thank you for joining us today to talk about your new book, The Age of Miracles.
Oh, thank you so much.
If you could begin just by telling us a little bit about yourself.
Well, this is my first book. And before, I wrote it while I was working as a book editor, actually. So I would get up in the mornings and just sort of had an hour a day to work on it. So that was it was a book that was written that way, sort of piece by piece, an hour at a time. And I am from California, but now I live in New York.
Did you work on fiction as a book editor, or what kind of projects did you work on?
I worked on fiction and nonfiction. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of the time that I was working in book publishing, I was working for editors who were higher up than me, and it was a lot of history and politics. And then, but on the side, I always wanted to be doing more fiction because that was sort of my first love.
So when did you start writing this book? What gave you the impetus to just sit down and start doing it?
I got the idea from something that really happened. I read a newspaper article shortly after the 2004 earthquake that caused the tsunami in Indonesia. I was in graduate school at the time, getting an MFA, and I read this story that said that that earthquake was so massive that it had affected the rotation of the Earth, and with the result of shortening the 24-hour day by a few microseconds. And when I read that, I couldn't believe that that was possible. I mean, I couldn't believe that. I had no idea that something like that was possible. And even though it was a slight change, I began to wonder right away, you know, what would happen if it had been a much larger change in the rotation. So I wrote a short story at the time in which actually the rotation of the Earth sped up in the short story. And then I set it aside for a couple of years, started working in book publishing. And when I went back to it, for some reason, this time it seemed like there might be more to the story, and maybe I could turn it into a novel. So the first change I made was to reverse it so that the rotation of the Earth was slowing down, and by a much greater amount than in the story or in real life. So that's where it came from.
Did you find you had to do a lot of research to understand what kind of impact that would have on people in their day-to-day?
Yeah, I did do research as I wrote. And a lot of times I would learn things from just reading the daily papers. I feel like there's so many strange stories, you know, in our real world about extreme weather or extinction of species, or, you know, if I would read something about sleep disorders or how people live in places where the sun doesn't rise in the winter or when it stays up all night in the summer, I was always trying to learn from all those stories. I tried to learn how people would react to a situation like the one I had created in the book. And then at the end, when I had a full draft, I did kind of work up the nerve to show it to an astrophysicist, which I was interested in doing all along, but I was a little, you know, it was just a little nerve-wracking. And I also wanted to make sure I, you know, could really own the story before I showed it to an expert who might, you know,
examine it right, exactly. Scientifically.
But it was actually a great relief. He was a wonderful reader, and I was relieved by how many of the things I had, the consequences I had written about, you know, he felt were based in real science. And then, of course, it's fiction, and I took some liberties, but he felt like once you take that leap, that the rotation of the Earth is slowing down, a lot of the consequences are based in real science. So that was, and then he helped me in a few places make it things a little bit more realistic when I had made an error. So
let's talk about the story a little bit. I mean, Julia is a wonderful character, and she's such a good voice. And she bears the burden of the story in a really interesting way. And I think that's makes her, she's strong and she's endearing, and she's clever. And I really like her as a heroine. How did you think about how to write the central character of the story?
You know, I as soon as I started writing this story, her voice, you know, a woman looking back in great detail on her childhood, that voice came to me. And so I always knew that it was going to be this young 11-year-old girl at the center, and her family. I don't know that I sat down in advance to think about exactly what her personality would be like, but she just grew as I told the story. And I mean, I certainly drew a little bit on my own memories of being her age. I mean, I grew up in California like she did. So the setting and the way she describes the landscape, that certainly comes from my own memories. And I do, even though I certainly, she's definitely not me, and I you know, made a lot of changes in her her personality and her definitely her experiences. But I do remember that age. It's just such an intense age. You know, it's this time where, friendships can kind of suddenly disintegrate for reasons that are hard to understand. You know, she's falling in love for the first time and noticing the things. Noticing that her parents aren't exactly who they think, and all those feelings, and how intense everything is at that age, that definitely is something that I remember vividly.
And this, I mean, I think that, you know, when I first came to this book, I was thinking it had this sort of, this apocalyptic theme, like this, you know, really life, world-changing event that's happening to the world. But I don't think that this book reads in the sort of science fiction-y way that I thought that it might. But I wondered if that's some of your influences. Like, did you think about sort of, you know, apocalyptic stories or great, you know, sort of writers in that genre to help you fill in the sort of what if questions and what will people do?
As a reader, I read my favorite things to read are anything that has a great story and great writing, and especially when there's great characters, you know, stories about people. And so I have a fairly wide range of books that I like to read. But I do, some of my favorites are books that, books like Blindness by Jose Saramago and The Road by Cormac McCarthy are definitely, you know, sort of touch on that apocalyptic type genre.
Right.
In a way that I really love and certainly was influenced by. And I think in both of those books, there's a real, there is this like a science fiction-ish premise, but there's so much attention to the people and how the small ways that they interact with one another, and so that I think that combination of a fascinating science fiction premise, but with a lot of complexity and nuance and good writing was those are definitely some of my favorite books to read, and certainly were influences on my book.
And I think what's interesting here too is that there isn't like an implosion of life as we knew it. It's sort of like news changes, and it's just this long process. And so it's taking that idea of like the time after, or thinking about the time before, and stretching it out, and thinking about how do people deal with the waiting, notice the changes. Like, how does that change the way you think about what's happening every day? Like, the chapter about celebrating Christmas is so, it's sad and it's so strange, but like people are holding on to all their traditions, and the world is just becoming stranger to them. So I love the way that you observe people in those moments that we call them cherished moments. We call them the things, the traditions that we have, or the things that mark our time here, and our people are still doing them, but with this eerie feeling.
Yeah.
And I think that the way that you constructed some of those moments were really, really so interesting, and helps you understand your characters so much in such a deeper way.
Thank you. So, I did want to kind of examine, rather than skipping to the world 100 years after a terrible event, I wanted to explore what that transitional period would be like, and I did want it to be a lot about our own real world. Like, even though it's off kilter in this book, I wanted it to be, you know, what if this happened tomorrow? How would we react, especially to like a slow motion catastrophe like this?
And with Julia, I mean, she has that perspective of being, she's remembering her life and living it. So you have that sort of change in her perspective throughout the book. And was that, where did you write her first? Did you write her young first? Did you write her looking back first?
I always knew that she was looking back. I mean, I wanted it to be about her childhood, her adolescence, and her family around her during that time. But I wanted the voice to be that of an adult, because I wanted to be able to draw on both the kind of special and unique vision of a young girl, where everything seems so intense, and especially Julia is sort of a natural observer anyway. I wanted that kind of eyesight, but I wanted also to be able to draw on the perspective and wisdom and insight of the older Julia, who's really the one telling the story. So it was definitely a choice to try to merge those two perspectives.
And this type of premise, like in fiction, is well, it's been around for a long time. You know, lots of classic authors have used these type of end of the world scenarios to explore what people would do. And it's become sort of having a renaissance in various iterations and types of books. I think that yours is pretty unique, but I want to know, you know, you tell the story about the 2004 earthquake, but what about that dramatically help you think about this story and the people that you write about here? I mean, do you look at their story as, you know, these are the times we live in and this is how we adjust, like, as a sense of optimism? Like, you call the book The Age of Miracles.
Right.
I mean, what does that dramatic event do for you as a writer in terms of, like, what kind of people you want to write about?
Well, I had never written anything with a sort of a fantastical premise before I wrote this book, but it just seemed immediately like a way to examine in close, vivid detail, you know, ordinary life. Like by putting ordinary life under threat, it was actually a way of kind of honing in on the kind of wonder of ordinary life. So, in the title, the way I think about the title is I chose it early on when, in the writing process, and I liked it because I liked the idea of miracle in a looser sense than we sometimes think about it, in the sense of just something that, an event that breaks with the rules of reality as we understand them, which I think the slowing of the rotation definitely falls into that type of category, something that no one ever thought could happen happens. And in another way, in a way that I'm very interested in, I think that adolescence for Julia is another age of miracles, because it's another time when things are changing around her. You know, friendships, people, just people's bodies, you know, voices, everything is just changing so quickly that it almost seems impossible. I mean, not hers in particular, but everyone's adolescence, I think, feels that way. And in terms of optimism or pessimism, it's hard to think of it in exactly that way. I just know that I wanted it to feel real, and so I just tried to follow the story in a way that would feel realistic and authentic and natural. So maybe I sort of landed wherever it is on the spectrum between optimism and pessimism. I just wanted it to feel real wherever that lands.
And the reality is, it's both, right?
Well, yeah. So. I mean, it's a scary story, but I hope there's like a lot of brightness in the lives. So,
thanks so much, Karen.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Yes.